Hello everyone, welcome back to the next module of our subject Business Law, and today's topic is Sales of Goods Act 1930. Let us start. What is Sales of Goods Act 1930? How it emerged? And as you all know, the very foundation of Indian society was based on the social contract. Especially that is the social contract theory. So thus contracts are the roots of the law which deals with business and transactions of the Indian economy as well as the society. The mother law being the Indian Contract Act 1872, we had derived the Sale of Goods Act 1930 from it. Thus, it helps to enhance, encourage and promote business transactions where the seller transfers or agrees to transfer the title in the goods to the buyer for consideration. The Indian Sale of Goods Act 1930 is a mercantile law which came into existence on 1st July 1930 during the British period. The Act was amended on 23rd September 1963 and was renamed to the Sale of Goods Act 1930. It is still in force in India. The Sale of Goods Act 1930 herein referred to as the act in law that governs the sale of goods in all parts of India. The act defines various terms which are contained in the act itself. Now, the formation of contract of sale of goods. A contract of sale of goods is a contract whereby the seller transfers or agrees to transfer the property in goods to buyer for a price. According to Section 4, Subsection 1, there may be a contract to sale between one part owner and the other. Contract of sale may be absolute or conditional according to Section 4, Subsection 2. The term contract of sale is a generic term and includes both sale and agreement to sell. Let us go to the next and very important point, that is sale and agreement to sell. When under a contract of sale, the property in the goods is transferred from the seller to the buyer, the contract act is called sale. But where the transfer of the property in the goods is to take place at a future time or subject to some conditions thereafter to be fulfilled, the contract is called an agreement to sell. Now here, in agreement to sell or sale, we need two persons. One is buyer, another one is seller. So who is buyer and seller according to the act? Let's see, as per the section 2, subsection 1 of the act, a buyer is someone who buys or has agreed to buy goods. Since a sale constitutes a contract between two parties, a buyer is one of the parties to the contract. The Act defines seller in Section 2, Subsection 13. A seller is someone who sells or has agreed to sell goods. For a sale contract to come into existence, both the buyer and seller must be defined by the Act. These two terms represent the two parties of sale contract. Essential element of contract of sale. Here I have mentioned five important essential elements. Number one is two parties. Number two is goods. Number three is price. Number four is transfer of general property. And fifth one is essential elements of a valid contract. Now let us talk about two parties. Two parties, there must be two distinct parties, that is a buyer and a seller, to affect a contract of sale, and they must be competent to contract. The second one is goods. The subject matter of contract of sale of goods is goods. According to Section 2, Subsection 7, goods means every kind of movable property other than actionable claims and money. What is price? Price is an essential ingredient for all transactions of sale, and in the absence of the price or the consideration, the transfer is not regarded as a sale. The transfer by way of sale must be in exchange for a price. Next is transfer of general property. there must be a transfer of general property as distinguishes from special property in goods from the seller to the buyer. For example, if A owns certain goods, he has general property in the goods. If he pledges them with B, B has a special property in the goods. Fifth one is essential elements of a valid contract. In addition to the aforesaid specific essential elements, all the essential elements of valid contract as specified under Section 10 of Indian Contract Act 1872 must also be present, since a contract of sale is a special type of contract. Now, let us talk about very special element of this Act, that is goods. One of the most crucial terms to define is goods that are to be included in the contract of sale of goods. The Act defines the terms goods in its Section 2, Subsection 7, as all types of movable property. The Section 2, Subsection 7 of the Act, it tells us every kind of movable property other than actionable claims and money, and includes stocks and shares, growing crops, grass and things attached to a farming part of the land which are agreed to be severed before sale or under the contract of sale will be considered goods. What are the example of goods? As goodwill, trademark, copyright, patent right, water, gas, electricity are some of the examples of goods. We say that goods are in a deliverable state when their condition is such that the buyer would, under the contract, be bound to take delivery of these goods. Goods may be further understood in the following subtypes. Now here you can see the classification of goods. So goods are divided into three categories. Number one is existing goods, number two is future goods, and number three is contingent. So existing is divided again in three parts. One is a specific, another one is ascertained, and third one is unsanctioned. Now let us talk about existing goods. Existing goods mean the goods which are either owned or possessed by the seller at the time of contract of sale. The existing goods may be specific or ascertained or unascertained as follows. As I told you that existing goods are divided in three categories. So the first category is specific goods that comes under Section 2, Subsection 14. Identified and agreed upon at the time when a contract of sale is made. For example, where A agrees to sell B a particular radio bearing a distinctive number, there is a contract of sale of specific or ascertained good. Next division of existing good is ascertained goods. Ascertained goods, when part of the goods lying in bulk or identified the earmarked for sale, such goods are termed as ascertained goods. Next is unsanctioned goods. This is again the part of existing goods. So these are the goods which are not defined and agreed upon at the time when the contract of sale is made. Example, goods in stock or lying in lots. For example, if A agrees to sell to B one bag of sugar out of the lot of 100 bags lying in his godown, it is a sale of unsanctioned goods because it is not known which bag is to be delivered. So as soon as a particular bag is separated from the lot for delivery, it becomes ascertained or specific goods. Next goods is future goods that comes under Section 2, Subsection 6. Future goods means goods to be manufactured or produced or acquired by the seller after the making of the contract of sale. So there can be an agreement to sell only. So there can be no sale in respect of future goods because one cannot sell what he does not possess. For example, X agrees to sell Y the mangoes which will be produced in the garden next year. It is contract of sale of future goods amounting to an agreement to sell. Third one is contingent goods. It is again the part of section 6, subsection 2. These are the goods, the acquisition of which by the seller depends upon a contingency which may or may not happen. For example, A agrees to sell specific goods in a particular ship to B to be delivered on the arrival of the ship. If the ship arrives, is not liable for the contract is to deliver the goods should they arrive. Now, next and very important part of this topic is sale and agreement to sell and its essentials. What is sale exactly? A contract of sale of goods is a type of contract whereby one party, that is seller, either transfers the ownership of goods or agrees to transfer it for money to the other party, that is buyer. Buyer and seller we had already discussed. A contract of sale can be a sale or an agreement to sell. So this all is the sale. What is agreement to sell? In contract of sale, where there is an actual sale of goods, it is known as sale. Whereas if there is an intention to sell the goods at a certain time in future, some conditions are satisfied, it is called an agreement to sell. Now, basically, you will get the questions, the comparison between sale and agreement sell, or the differences between sale and agreement sell. So I am going to discuss about the comparison. So comparison will take place on the basis of title, on the basis of type of contract, basis of nature, right to sell, tax, and suit for breach of contract by the seller and the right of unpaid seller. Now let's see the differences on the basis of title. Title in sale. In sale, the title of goods transfers to the buyer with the transfer of goods. But in agreement sale, the title of goods remains with the seller as there is no transfer of goods. What kind of contract is sale? Contract, the sale is the type of executed contract, whereas agreement sale is the type of executory contract. So this is the difference between these two. And the sale is absolute in nature, but agreement sale is conditional in nature. Sale, the right to sell in sale is buyer is having, but in agreement sale, the right to sell is seller is having. Tax, sale, VAT is charged as the time of sale, but in agreement sale, no tax is levied. In sale, the buyer can claim damage from the seller and proprietary remedy from the party to whom the goods are sold. But in agreement sale, the buyer has the right to claim damage only. Then, right to sue for the price, that is the part of sale, but right to sue for damages, it is the part of agreement sale. So here these are the main differences between sale and agreement sale. Next topic is stipulation, condition and warranty. A representation which forms part of the contract of sale and affects the contract is called stipulation. A stipulation which is most important for formation of the contract of sale is known as condition. A stipulation which is collateral or of least importance for the formation of the contract sale is known as warranty. What is conditions? According to section 12, subsection 2 of the Sale of Goods Act 1930 defines conditions as a stipulation essential to the main purpose of the contract, the breach of which gives rise to right to treat the contract as repudiated. Example, buyer wanted a horse which could run at a speed of 45 mph. There are some implied conditions. I have taken 6 implied conditions. First one is condition as to title. Second one is condition as to sample. Third one is condition as to sample as well as description. Fourth one is condition as to mercantility. Fifth one is condition as to wholesomeness. So these all are the implied conditions. Now here I am stopping my lecture, and in the very next module we are going to discuss about condition and warranty, doctrine of caveat emptor, and simultaneously we are going to take unpaid seller in the next module. Thank you very much for patient listening.